Achieving boardroom gender balance is vital to building successful life science companies, but the industry must do more to make this a reality. That's according to a major report published by RSA, the Global Life Sciences Executive Search and Interim Management Specialist. Nick Stevens is CEO of RSA and joins us now. Nick, this issue with women in boardrooms is dominating current human resources debate. In general terms, what are your findings?
Hi. The general findings are that everybody agrees that diversity in boards is important. There's a consensus that women bring different skills and different approaches into the boardroom, though I think we need to be careful to check that they're not just stereotypes. And there's also a very strong reaction to the suggestion that quotas should be imposed by law. So there's an awful lot of agreement that women bring something different to a boardroom and that brings value. But strong reaction against being forced to bring more women into boards.
The report concentrates on the life sciences sector. Is the life sciences sector unusual, or does it have a lot of common ground with other areas of corporate Britain?
Well, I'm sad to say that it has a lot of common ground with other areas of corporate Britain. We started this piece of work believing that life sciences industries would be more egalitarian. In part, that's because they are science-based and science is a much better gender-balanced endeavour than most. It's also, of course, more data-driven than most decision-making areas. So, and third, we also believe that life sciences' bedrock is in innovation, and so that they would be more accepting of change. So we expected to find that the boards of life sciences companies would be more diverse, better populated by women than the general UK industry. But in fact, it's very like, it's almost exactly similar in terms of the proportions of contributions by women on boards as the rest of the UK industry.
Nick, we often hear about glass ceilings. Is this true in the life science sector?
Yes, I'm afraid it is. The statistics demonstrate that. It's surely not a conscious thing. I think it's something to do with speed of change of boards, board stickiness. There's a lack of turnover of board members in responses to changes in the phase or the stage of the company or to market influences. I think once it's recognized that changing boards in changing circumstances is good, and if you combine that with a statement of intent, then some clear recruitment, planning, coaching, mentoring type programs, the issue will resolve itself over time, but I think that'll take 5 to 10 years.
Nick, your report highlights a number of key trends, including the need for balance and diversity, quotas, and staff development. Now, it's clear that a board should bring talents from a number of areas, but do women bring different talents to a boardroom than men?
We have to be careful here about stereotypes. The consensus is that women bring more empathy, more pragmatism, and more awareness of the impact of board decisions on the rest of the stakeholders than men do. I was concerned that that might simply be consensus reinforcing stereotype, but actually I believe they do bring different
Nick,
skills.
Nick, quotas, you say, are not the answer, but there are countries that do operate a quota system, like Norway, for example, which seems to work.
Yeah, so this is another one of those questions about cause and effect, I think. You're right, Norway, Finland are real exemplars of diversity on boards, whether that's educational background, social background, or gender balance. But if you look at those societies, they are real exemplars of that kind of thing anyway. So the question is, will quotas work in forcing people to do that? Yes, of course, that would increase the number of females on boards, but I'm not sure whether it would improve the decision making of those boards, because you might just find that decision making shifts to, you know, the pre-board dinner or places where ladies are not allowed to contribute. In a society where women contribute equally and are seen as equals in business to men, then a quota will work because those people will be included in decision making. So I think, you know, people resent anything that forces behaviour on them, and that skews the usefulness of those things.
So will it come to quotas, do you think, in the UK, or will the law stop short of this?
I would be deeply surprised if the UK government imposed quotas, but I would not be at all surprised if the European Parliament did.
So how about the implementation of staff development programmes?
This is key. If you accept the self-evident truth that a diversity of opinion, a diversity of approach is good for a decision-making body, is good for any endeavour, then you can only do better by preparing people, by giving them the skills and understanding they need in order to contribute at that level when they get the opportunity to apply. So that's all about succession planning, coaching, mentoring, enabling people to give their best in a company.
Nick, your report suggests that some of the biggest barriers to women in the boardroom comes from the issue of boardroom culture and life choices. How do women overcome these issues?
Okay, well, I think there are two issues here. There's culture and business. So the corporate, the business piece, is about the need to embrace change. It's about the need for boards to review their own competence and their own fit to the company's current needs. So it's also about cost. It typically costs more than the board member's fee to replace a non-executive director. And it's also about closed networks. You know, people tend to hire people they know because they are seen as being a lower risk. A cynic might say that they're also less likely to challenge the status quo and to bring new ideas, and to disagree with their board members if you hire people that you already know. But I think those factors are all changeable. You can decide that you're going to have a robust board hiring policy in the same way that you'd have a robust hiring policy at any level below that. From a societal point of view, I think there are very strong positive signs. You can't change the biology. You can't change the fact that it is women who have babies, and often they make their choice to bring them up. But the new open, networked, technology-enabled world that we're building, I think it's going to be much more conducive to female participation and should make it much less impactful for women to take a career break to look after children.
So on an overview, what should we take away from this report?
I think first that it is self-evident that diversity brings strength to any endeavour. Second, that if we plan diversity into our boards, then we will build better companies and we'll build more value. There are hundreds of properly qualified, eager to contribute women out there, so that boards can start to review themselves, to review their performance and their contribution, and to recognize that it's their duty to step aside for a new generation when that's in the best interest of the stakeholders, and then to appoint the best candidate out there. We'll all do better.
Great. Nick, thanks for joining us. Nick Stevens there, CEO of RSA.
You're welcome. Thank you.